Like so many things, this is a program about relationships. We've already told you about how the dollar can affect commodities, or commodity prices affect the dollar. Now it's time to take a look at the unique relationship between commodities prices and the bond. And John, this is the big one. Every time everybody gets nervous about inflation, they start worrying, the bond market sinks. This is what this all relationship is all about, isn't it?
Ted, of all the relationships that we use, this is really the fulcrum. This is the main one. The link between commodity prices that are actively traded on the various markets and the bond market. Unfortunately, a lot of economists, for example, don't look at these things. We believe this is the right place to look for early signs of inflation.
All right, like we always like to do here, let's give you a long overview. We go back 20 years with a chart of the commodities and bond prices, and I guess the point here is what? They move in different directions?
Just to show people that they do clearly move in opposite directions. Some people don't think that's the case, or they may doubt it. I've heard some people argue that point. We simply want to show this. Now, we're going back 20 years. This takes us back to 1980. During the 1970s, we had this tremendous inflationary boom. If you look to the far left, you'll notice that a big move up in the CRB index there, which is the bar chart. Commodities actually hit their major high back in 1980, and they've basically been moving down ever since then.
But I remember that was back when mortgage rates were like 15%.
That's exactly right. So you can see that, generally speaking, we've been in the disinflationary period since 1980 in commodity prices. But you can see the solid line there, those are the bond prices, Treasury bond prices. You can see, in fact, Treasury bond prices bottomed in 1981, and they've basically been moving up ever since then. So we've had almost a 20-year bear market in commodity prices and a 20-year bull market in bond prices.
What are these lines that we look at here, which seem to show the extremes on both ends?
We're simply trying, I just tried to pick the major turning points, and just to show, for example, that there's also a lead and a lag time. For example, to the far left, we just wanted to show that commodity prices peaked in 1980. Bond prices turned up about a year later. So sometimes there's a little bit of a lead and a lag. You notice 1984, for example, that second vertical line. We had a serious decline in commodity prices that coincided with the trough in bond prices. They move in opposite directions. The third line, 1986, notice a big uptick in commodity prices and a big downtick in bond prices. By the way, we're going to show a little bit later on that uptick in commodity prices in 1986, 1987, and that decline in bond prices led to the stock market crash of 1987. We'll talk about that a little bit later.
Again, let's move it now to the extreme upper right-hand corner of this chart and tell us what's in this box and what is that telling us, at least at this moment.
Yes, Ted. Again, we're in the middle of 1999. We're just trying to make the case that for the first time in a long time, we're beginning to see some serious signs of weakness in the bond market. And that has serious implications if that is really happening. And we're going to focus on that particular time period.
So the big question is, perhaps are bonds peaking in 1999? And we are looking now at a chart of Treasury bonds. And it looks certainly like we have seen the best on this chart.
Yes, if you look at it by itself, Ted, this is a weekly bar chart of Treasury bond prices, and you'll notice that we actually peaked in October of last year, 1998, and we've had a serious decline ever since then. That solid line running through the chart is one of our technical indicators. It's the 40-week moving average. Generally speaking, when bond prices break that 40-week moving average to the downside, it's normally been followed by serious declines. And also you'll notice that the index itself, the average, has started to drop. So we're just trying to make the case here that bond prices have fallen quite sharply during 1999. That, of course, coinciding with interest rates moving up. So the bond market looking quite bearish at this point.
We should point out, for those of you who have heard about various commodities indices, there are a number of them, and we're going to show you different ones. Each one kind of gives a little different picture of where the price pressure may be. There's the CRB index, there's the Goldman Sachs Commodities Index, there's a Journal of Commerce Index. There are a number of them, and each tells a different story, doesn't it?
It is, Ted. And just to back up here, when bond prices are dropping, why that is significant is that if commodity prices are rising, that does seem to confirm that there's an inflationary problem. The problem is you have to look at the right commodity index. Now, the first chart we're going to look at is the CRB index, which is probably the best known of the commodity indexes. In this case, it may not be the best, and we're simply showing on this particular chart that this index is still below its 200-day moving average. As you can see, it's been moving sideways since the spring. It looks like it's bottoming out, but to really turn up, it would have to hit a new high for the year and break above that 200-day moving average. The reason the Commodity Research Bureau has not moved up at this particular point is that it's very heavily weighted toward the agricultural markets, like the grain markets, for example. And that has largely been a depressant on this particular
issue. So the overall picture here is a downtrend and then some sideways movement from about March on.
But
as we go to the next, right, but no uptrend. But as we go to the next chart, a whole different story because it's a different kind of index.
Exactly. This next chart is the Goldman Sachs Commodity Index. This is a newer index. And how this differs from the Commodity Research Bureau is that this weights each commodity according to its importance in world trade. It has a very heavy energy weighting. And as a result, you can see a dramatically different picture. The Goldman Sachs Index actually bottomed late in 1998. But you'll notice that in the spring of this year, right around March of 1999, the Goldman Sachs Commodity Index just began to erupt. It's well above its 200-day moving average. So this is clearly in an uptrend. But as I mentioned, a lot of this is energy prices. In fact, this particular index, up to the middle of 1999, is up about 30%. Energy prices, oil prices, have doubled during that period of time. But clearly, if you look at the Goldman Sachs Commodity Index, this does imply that commodities are moving higher. That suggests
certain commodities.
Right. That does suggest the possibility of an inflation thing developing here, and that confirms, that seems to explain why the bond market has been so weak so far this year.
And we do remember, of course, that OPEC finally got its act together, if you will, around that time we start to see oil prices stabilize, and so we're seeing that play out, whereas, if I recall correctly, at that point in 1999, in terms of agricultural commodities, we had a lot of wheat, a lot of corn, and prices were somewhat depressed. On we go to industrial metals, another chart and another way of measuring commodities prices, but different commodities.
Right, and this is a very important group, Ted, because when we talk about industrial metals, we're talking about copper, aluminum, lead, tin, zinc, not precious metals, industrial metals. These are commodities that are very sensitive to economic trends, especially global economic trends. And the point of this chart is simply to show that it isn't just the oil market that has been going up this year. In fact, this particular index, this is the Goldman Sachs Index of Industrial Metals. This particular index, as you can see, has also been moving up quite sharply during 1999. In fact, it's up about 20%. That's very important because it suggests it's not just the oil market that's rallying, but certain key commodities. And why these commodities are important is because they're not affected by the weather. These, like corn and soybeans, for example, these are commodities that are influenced by economic trends.
Now, also, just to work this inner market in a little bit more and keep the global perspective, this is on or about the time when we started to hear that perhaps the worst was over in the Pacific Rim.
That's right, and we're going to get into that a little bit later. We're going to talk about global influences that we're going to show that this pickup in these industrial commodity prices is really tied to events that are going on
so
in other parts of the world.
The grains, first of all, domestic, but here we start to see oil demand perhaps overseas, as well as the OPEC situation. It's a whole beautiful little story that all gets packaged in one chart in some cases.
And Ted, to give it an economic spin, which is what we do, that if the industrial commodity prices are picking up, that means that the markets are moving up around the world, the economies are strengthening, and that explains why interest rates are moving higher.
Let's take a look at the next chart here. This is a chart of the Goldman Sachs Index. We're looking at rising commodities prices. And I guess bond yields trade in tandem, don't they?
Yeah, we're flipping it around. If commodities and bond prices move in opposite directions, then commodities and interest rates move in the same direction. Or another way to say it, that when you get rising commodity prices, that means rising inflation, that means rising interest rates. And the whole point of this chart, the chart along the top is the Goldman Sachs Index that we already looked at. The chart along the bottom are U.S. Treasury bond yields, and you can hardly tell the two apart. And that's the whole point, that into the beginning of 1999, commodity prices were in a downtrend, bond yields were in a downtrend. However, both indexes broke their downtrend lines right around the same time, right around the first quarter of 1999. And the whole point of this is simply to show that there is a link between rising commodity prices and rising interest rates. And that's the whole point of that chart. And that's really the basis of intermarket analysis.
But we're not done with the links, because when we come back, we're going to show you a link between what bonds do and what stocks do.
Let's review the material that Ted and I just talked about. When we discussed the relationship between commodities and bond prices, the key relationship to remember is that they generally move in opposite direction. Therefore, when you have a falling CRB index, for example, that's generally good for the bond market. You'll notice, however, that when the CRB index or commodity prices in general are moving up, bond prices tend to move down. Now, it's also important to remember that bond prices and bond yields also move in opposite directions. Therefore, when commodity prices are rising and bond prices are falling, that also means that bond yields are moving higher. Another way to say that is that commodity prices and bond yields generally move in the same direction. Throughout most of 1999, for example, we've seen a situation where commodity prices and bond yields have been moving up together. Now, in the next section, Ted and I will move on to another very crucial intermarket relationship, and that is the link between the bond market and the stock market.